2018 was a year full of headlines, and sadly, some of the biggest headlines told us of the deaths of some very famous people. Those passings came in the worlds of entertainment, business, and even some Americans who were literally out of this world. But in this installment, we examine the unforgettable figures we lost in politics, sports, and the media. But we begin with a man who brought the gospel to millions of people around the world.
And then he dropped his head and said, "It's finished." What did he mean? He meant your plan of salvation was finished. God can now forgive you of all your sins because Jesus had finished God's plan for your salvation.
Evangelist Billy Graham began traveling the country in the 1940s, imploring people to turn from their sins and put their faith in Jesus Christ. The Billy Graham Crusades eventually went global, making him one of the most recognizable people on earth. Graham is believed to have spoken to more people in person than anyone in history, and he was consistently named among the most admired men in America. Also a friend or counselor to many presidents, Billy Graham was 99 when he died in February. One of Graham's closest friends to reside in the White House was our 41st president, George Bush. Bush was quite possibly the most qualified person to become president in American history. The World War II aviator served as a congressman, envoy to the United Nations and China, CIA director, and then 8 years as vice president for Ronald Reagan. Bush won the White House while carrying 40 states in an Electoral College landslide over Michael Dukakis in 1988. In office for just 4 years, Bush presided over major moments in history, such as the fall of the Berlin Wall and the collapse of the Soviet Union and the Iron Curtain. He also led an international coalition to evict Iraq from Kuwait in 1991.
As Commander-in-Chief, I can report to you our armed forces fought with honor and valor. And as President, I can report to the nation, aggression is defeated, the war is over.
Bush's popularity was sky high after the Gulf War, but a year later he was in political peril. He faced a primary challenge from within his own party, an upstart Democratic nominee in Bill Clinton, and a major hurdle in the independent candidacy of Ross Perot. Bush also could not recover from breaking this campaign promise from 1988.
My opponent won't rule out raising taxes, but I will, and the Congress will push me to raise taxes, and I'll say no. And they'll push, and I'll say no. And they'll push again, and I'll say to them, read my lips. No new taxes.
Clinton won the presidency in 1992. Bush later teamed up with him to raise disaster relief funds following hurricanes, tsunamis, and earthquakes. In 2001, Bush became just the second American president to be alive when his son was sworn in as president. Bush was 94 when he died in November. No president has ever lived longer. And no presidential marriage was longer than that of George and Barbara Bush, 73 years. Barbara Bush was a beloved first lady who carried herself lightly but also with dignity while championing the cause and importance of literacy. The wife of one president and mother of another, Barbara Bush was 92 when she died in April.
Tonight, I have a privilege given few Americans. The privilege of accepting our party's nomination for President of the United States.
John McCain was also a war hero, surviving more than 5 years of physical and mental torture by the North Vietnamese in the infamous Hanoi Hilton. Less than a decade after returning home, McCain was elected to Congress in 1982 and to the Senate 4 years later, winning 6 Senate terms in all. McCain's political career almost flamed out in his first Senate term when he was linked to the Charles Keating and savings and loans crisis. That experience later turned McCain into a fierce advocate for campaign finance reform. McCain also waged two memorable presidential campaigns. In 2000, he lost an intense battle for the GOP nomination to Texas Governor George W. Bush. In 2008, he came back from the political scrap heap to win the Republican presidential nomination. However, McCain was soundly defeated by Illinois Senator Barack Obama in the general election. McCain won 2 more elections to the Senate after that before being diagnosed with brain cancer in 2017. After surgery, he provided the decisive vote against a bill to repeal major parts of Obamacare. McCain spent his final 8 months at home, dying in August, just days shy of his 82nd birthday. One of McCain's Senate colleagues was Georgia Democrat Zell Miller, who became known for his alliance with President George W. Bush. Miller co-sponsored Bush's first tax cut bill and was a staunch supporter of the military. Miller even delivered the keynote address at the 2004 Republican convention, where he accused Democratic nominee John Kerry of being weak on the military.
Against the Patriot missile that shot down Saddam Hussein's Scud missiles over Israel, against the Aegis air defense cruiser, against the Strategic Defense Initiative, against the Trident missile, against. This is the man who wants to be the commander-in-chief of the U.S. Armed Forces. U.S. Forces armed with what? Spitballs?
Zell Miller was 86 when he died in March. One of the key Republican senators in the Reagan Revolution was Nevada's Paul Laxalt. Also a governor of the Silver State, Laxalt was pivotal in encouraging Reagan's rise to national office. Paul Laxalt died in August. He was 96. Reagan became president after defeating Jimmy Carter in 1980. The Carter administration lost one of its most prominent officials this year with the passing of former CIA director Stansfield Turner. He was 94. In the House, one of the longest-serving Democrats died this year. New York's Louise Slaughter rose to chair the House Rules Committee and was in that position during the tumultuous debates over Obamacare and the Obama stimulus package. Louise Slaughter was 88.
The decision to go to war without specific authorization by the Security Council has created deep divisions that will need to be bridged if we are to deal effectively, not just with the aftermath of Iraq, but with other major challenges on the international agenda.
Kofi Annan of Ghana served two terms as Secretary General of the United Nations. Annan vigorously opposed the Iraq War, but also found himself in the crosshairs of the oil for food scandal related to Iraq. Kofi Annan was 80. Several prominent media figures also left us in 2018.
Every time liberals lose, they accuse the other side of all kinds of isms.
Charles Krauthammer was a psychologist turned Democratic speechwriter who then transformed into one of the most respected conservative thinkers and columnists in the nation. Known for his elegant prose and piercing arguments, Krauthammer found a whole new level of stardom as a regular commentator on the Fox News Channel. Charles Krauthammer was 68.
You give it to them! You let them have it! This is good! This is great for America! This isn't about appeasing a bunch of negative Nellies that are sitting in the room that want to see you fail!
Ed Schultz was the opposite of Charles Krauthammer, liberal and bombastic. Known for his primetime shows on MSNBC and his advocacy for organized labor, Ed Schultz was 64. Tom Wolfe was one of the most acclaimed novelists of our time. Best known for The Right Stuff and Bonfire of the Vanities, Tom Wolfe was 88. Anthony Bourdain was a chef who became a media star thanks to his best-selling book, Kitchen Confidential. Recently, he was host of Anthony Bourdain, Parts Unknown on CNN. However, Bourdain took his own life in June. He was 61. Mort Walker was a World War II veteran who spent the next several decades poking fun at the Army in his classic comic strip Beetle Bailey. The creator of characters ranging from Sergeant Snorkel to General Half-Track to Zero, Mort Walker was 90.
Good morning, Vietnam. It's just a smidgen past 6:05, and here we go with another day's version of the Don Buster Show from Armed Forces Radio. I'm Airman Adrian Kronauer, and for the next 4 hours, we've got the best in popular music for you here, so let's get started.
The most famous military broadcaster of all time was Adrian Kronauer, famously portrayed by Robin Williams in the movie Good Morning Vietnam. Adrian Kronauer was 79 when he died in July. For 50 years, Connie Long covered the White House for a variety of media outlets and even served a stint as Radio America's White House correspondent. A great friend to her colleagues, Connie Long was 73. Late-night radio listeners loved Art Bell and his deep discussions into what the worlds beyond our world may hold. Bell was 72. The sports world lost a number of renowned media personalities in 2018. Paul Zimmerman broke down the NFL for Sports Illustrated for decades. Dr. Z was 81. Dave Anderson was a Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist for the New York Times. One of the most respected writers in the nation, Anderson was 89 when he died in October. Bill Knack could tell a story like few others. a great chronicler of many sports for Sports Illustrated and others, but perhaps best known for his coverage of Secretariat's Triple Crown in 1973, Knack was 77 when he died in April.
If it is still so that a Big Ten football team wants that conference title more than any national championship, then we should have ourselves a cracking good game today in Ann Arbor.
Whoa, Nelly. Few voices in sports are as instantly recognizable as that of Keith Jackson. Synonymous with the biggest college football game of the week, Jackson was a fixture as the lead announcer for ABC Sports. The great Keith Jackson was 89 when he died in January. Elsewhere in the sports world, Roger Bannister became an instant global star in 1954 when he became the first person to run a mile in fewer than 4 minutes. Bannister was 89 when he died in March. In football, few teams were more dominant than the Green Bay Packers in the 1960s, and no one typified the gritty Lombardi era as well as running back Jim Taylor. Taylor helped the Packers win 4 NFL titles and was the first running back in league history to rush for 1,000 yards in 5 consecutive seasons. Jim Taylor was 83 when he died in October. Taylor was drafted out of LSU in 1958. The next season, the Tigers won the national championship behind star running back Billy Cannon. The next year, all Cannon did was win the Heisman Trophy as the best player in the nation. Billy Cannon was 80. Few people loved Ohio State like Earl Bruce. Bruce coached the Buckeyes for 9 seasons following the firing of Woody Hayes. His teams went 5-4 against rival Michigan and even went to 2 Rose Bowls. Bruce was 87. In the NFL, Dwight Clark won 2 Super Bowls as a receiver for the San Francisco 49ers. But Clark is best known for the catch. In the 1981 NFC Championship game against Dallas, quarterback Joe Montana lobbed a pass towards the back of the end zone. Clark caught it with his fingertips. The 49ers won by a point and advanced to the first of their 6 Super Bowls. Clark died of ALS in June at the age of 61. Edwin Jackson was a promising young linebacker for the Indianapolis Colts, but he sadly made headlines in February when he was struck and killed along a highway by a drunk driver who was in the country illegally. Jackson was just 26 years old. Chuck Knox was a head coach for 22 years in the NFL and went to the playoffs 11 times with the Rams, Bills, and Seahawks. Known by some as Ground Chuck for his emphasis on running the ball, Chuck Knox was 86. 3 prominent NFL owners died in 2018. Tom Benson owned the New Orleans Saints and was heralded for helping to rebuild New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. Benson was 90. Bob McNair owned the Houston Texans. He died in November at the age of 81. And Wayne Huizenga built a blockbuster of a business and a dumpster of a business, literally. The man behind Blockbuster Video and Waste Management later bought the Miami Dolphins and the Florida Marlins. He owned the Marlins when they won the 1997 World Series. Wayne Huizenga was 80. There's one other NFL owner who died this year, who we'll get to in a little bit. Elsewhere in baseball, we lost Rusty Staub. A fan favorite in multiple cities, Staub was most beloved by fans of the Expos and Mets. A 6-time All-Star and one of the great people and personalities of the game, Rusty Staub was 73 when he died in March. One of basketball's great winners was JoJo White of the Boston Celtics. A gold medalist for the U.S. in the 1968 Summer Olympics, White later won 2 titles with the Celtics, winning Finals MVP honors in 1976. A 7-time All-Star, JoJo White was 71. Phil Jackson won 11 NBA titles behind the genius of the triangle offense. That strategy was the brainchild of assistant coach Tex Winter. Also a successful college coach, Winter died in October. He was 96. Hal Greer was a 10-time All-Star for the Syracuse Nationals and Philadelphia 76ers. The stellar guard helped the Sixers to the 1967 NBA title. Hal Greer was 81. In 1987, Indiana won its last NCAA championship, and forward Daryl Thomas found Keith Smart for the game-winning shot. By unselfishly giving up the ball to an open teammate, Coach Bob Knight called Thomas's decision the single greatest play I ever had a kid make. Thomas died of a heart attack in March. He was 52. In hockey, one of Chicago's greatest legends was Stan Mikita. The Slovakian immigrant evolved from a hockey bad boy to one of the most dominant centers of his generation and helped the Blackhawks capture a Stanley Cup. Stan Mikita was 78. In golf, Doug Ford captured 19 titles on tour as well as 2 major wins in the 1957 Masters and the 1955 PGA Championship. Ford was 95 when he died in May. And in professional wrestling, two legends died this year. The great Bruno Sammartino entertained fans for decades. He was 82. Jim the Anvil Neidhart was brilliant as a heel in the WWE. Neidhart was 63. In business, everyone connects Bill Gates to the tech giant Microsoft, but Paul Allen was also there every step of the way as the business evolved from a garage to one of the greatest success stories in history. Allen later bought the Seattle Seahawks and the Portland Trail Blazers. He died in October at the age of 65. Rich DeVos turned the Amway Corporation into a massive success, and the great philanthropist then poured his good fortune into a wide array of charities and community projects in and around his hometown of Grand Rapids, Michigan. The father-in-law of Education Secretary Betsy DeVos was 92. William Coors did not start the beer company in Colorado, but it probably seemed that way to many after so many years of running the business. William Coors was 102. And Kate Spade was one of the most successful fashion leaders in America. Famous for her handbags, Spade tragically took her own life in June. She was just 55. That's a look at some of the biggest names from politics, media, sports, business, and beyond to leave us in 2018. Be sure to find our look back at the legends from music, television, the movies, and more on this same site. I'm Greg Corumbus, reporting for Radio America.